everyone. I'm Sonia, and we are at Indaba Yoga in London with, can I call you the breath guru?
No.
With Alan Dolan. And Alan has been working with something called transformational breath for almost 11 years.
Yeah, right about that.
Yeah? Transformational breath work is really a profound modality to heal the body, but most of us don't really know much about it. So, Alan, can you share?
Sure. Well, the fact of the matter is, most of us don't breathe very well, really. Yeah. The average Joe on the street is using about 20% of their respiratory capacity. And of course, there's a lot more that we can access. So one of the things that transformational breath does is it allows us to access this extra capacity. Mm. If you're a yogi or a sports person, you might be using up to, say, 50%, but there's still a whole lot that you can access. So essentially what we do is teach people how to open up the areas that are closed down. And most of us have areas within the respiratory system that are closed down. A lot of us are upper chest breathers, about 80% of the population breathe in this area,
right,
but there's nothing happening down in the lower abdomen. 20% of us are in the abdomen,
yeah,
but nothing happening up top. So what we want to do is get everything working at the same time.
Right. And if we get, so let's just say we are yogis or sports people, and we are using 50%. Mm. What does using the other 50% get us?
Good question.
So the key really is, yeah, it's a connected breath. And a connected breath is simply a breath that is always moving. But when you breathe in a connected fashion, your frequency is going to go up. You're going to go into a higher vibratory state. When that happens, your body goes into this autopilot reboot mode.
Okay.
So anything that's out of balance, out of line, on a physical level, on the mental, emotional level, even on the spiritual level, starts to move back towards balance and harmony. So even if you are this super sports person or super yogi, and I work a lot with yogis, there's still work to do. There's still stuff we can
do. Yes, there's always stuff.
Yeah,
exactly. I mean, there's definitely always stuff.
Yeah.
So if we raising our consciousness, which is our frequency rather, you said, is like what? Exciting our own electromagnetic energy?
Really nice way to think about it. I've never heard it described like that, but yeah, it's exactly that. When we go into a higher vibrational state, basically all of the work that needs to get done in the body, it's almost like a catalyst for that work. So when you go into a higher vibrational state, any lower vibrational energies which are hanging around in the same area tend to entrain to the higher vibration. It's a principle of, I did it in like O-level physics or something, you know, the principle is entrainment.
Yes.
The most commonly cited example of entrainment is when women share accommodation together, the menstrual cycles can decide. Okay, that would be an example of entrainment. So what we're doing is we're creating this high vibrational energy field, and then all of our stuff, baggage, things that tends to entrain. So it's not like we create or we destroy energy, but we can get it to change form. Hence transformational breath. So as you heard in the workshop today, you know, a lot of people having quite emotional experiences, divesting baggage, which is great. It wasn't we were destroying it, was just we were getting it, I think of it as going into a non-toxic form.
Yeah, you know, okay, so I've just finished a workshop we started at 1:30 and we ended at 4:30, and I just need to share my experience. I've heard a lot about transformational breathing and holotropic breathwork and rebirthing. So these are really becoming very commonly thrown around these days. So when I saw Alan was in town, I was like, wow, I've got to talk to him. You know, he's the dude right now. I have to speak to him about this breathwork. Anyway, I came, but I made sure that I didn't have any kind of pre-idea of what I wanted this to be. Because my natural, you know, you can overthink things and you can really kind of, you know, just chew on them a bit too much. So I thought, that's it. I'm not going to read anything. I'm not going to dive into any information. I just want to feel this without any cognitive stuff going on.
Perfect.
So I arrived and we had obviously the introduction, which is amazing. Knowledge is power. You need to know where you're going. Then we lay down and we started this breath work, and obviously to the description and the rhythm, and I love the four principles. So mouth, you have to breathe through your mouth. you have to breathe into your abdominals and you have to connect the breaths, and then you have to allow, let go. So these are the principles of the breathing. And so we all lay down. Can I just say that it felt like 20 minutes. So when the 20 minutes in my mind, I was like, yeah, that was amazing. I released sound, and when you offer, you know, there's two things to release the energy. You can tone, so you release sound. But in my mind, I was thinking, I won't need to do that. That's fine. I won't need to. Well, I did. And it was amazing. It's really quite powerful. Yes. So that was really lovely. I really felt that was an unexpected behavior. I didn't expect that. You see, we don't always know what we're going to do. And that was lovely. Mm-hmm. It was unexpected. Anyway, so when the 15 minutes were over, sort of roll myself up, turn around and thought, well, what next? When, what, are you going to go into something else? And then I gazed back at the clock and we'd been there for an hour and a half.
Yeah.
That was amazing.
Yeah, yeah. So
that was amazing.
Really, your response was so funny because it's a very typical response. People are like, no, it can't be. It must have been. When you've changed the clock, it's about coming out of the head.
Yeah.
What this is about, you said it today, feel it.
Yeah.
You know, that's perfect. That's perfect because it's really about that. It's about coming out of your head, coming into the body, really feeling your body. And your body's got a totally different sense of time than the mind. So we just go right out of our normal appreciation, you could say, of time.
Yeah.
So I think your attitude towards turning up was like, that's the perfect thing.
Yeah.
And you said the four components, you were listening, brilliant.
Yeah.
So mouth breath, yes, we do breathe through our mouths.
Yeah.
Two, it is an abdominal breath. Three, the most important thing, it's a connected breath.
I love the description that you gave about the ping pong. That really helped me.
Yeah.
The, you know, when it was the ping pong of the video game that
it's exactly that, because you know, most of the time human beings breathe in a disconnected fashion.
Yeah.
Disconnected means you have pauses at either end of the inhale and exhale.
Mm.
So when you delete those pauses, it becomes a connected breath. In other words, you're breathing in a continuous flow. And that's what affects your frequency. That's what puts you up into the higher vibratory state. So to illustrate that, I usually use the video game.
Yeah.
Because, I don't know, do you remember those? The first
video?
Do you?
I do.
Okay, all right.
The very early ones. And they were very simple, weren't they?
Yeah.
Exactly. And the ball just went. It's
that thing, it was the movement. Boop. And then.
And as it touches, it carries on
exactly,
and it goes.
And that's what you do with the breath.
Yeah.
You touch and you're gone. And you touch and you're gone.
Yeah.
And that's. You just keep it moving like that.
It's so interesting because. Okay, so. I could really go down lots of different paths here, but what was really, really interesting for me was, you know, it was unexpected. You don't have, you think, if you think too much, but you do think, I won't do this, I won't do that, but I heard a lot of people in the room, some people I heard really vocal, very vocal, some people were very emotional. And then afterwards, the feedback was some people were incredibly physical.
Yeah, yeah.
There was a lot of physical stuff going on. So
it's different for everybody. Every single person shows up at the workshop with different needs. We're unique on the planet. There's nobody like you, and there's nobody like me.
Yeah.
So our job is to be exactly who we are.
Right? Yeah.
That's what we're here for. So what the breath does is it allows you to get rid of the facades.
Yeah.
So you can just be you.
Yeah.
I can just be me.
Yes.
And isn't that lovely?
Yeah, yes,
it's really,
that lovely.
It's just
I'll be me, you'll be you,
and we'll all
be a happy earth. Wow, wouldn't that be great?
There you go. So fantastic. But what happens is that some of us have got physical stuff we need to clear. Loads of us, whole tension
loads.
In our bodies, so that releases.
Yeah.
You know, hands up, who does not have any baggage?
Totally.
We've all got stuff. We're all human, we all suppress and repress. So it's a really, really effective way of just getting rid of that baggage.
Yeah.
And then spiritually, because you're going up into this high vibratory state, it's easy then to connect with other high vibrational energies, the so-called spiritual brothers. So there's a spiritual dimension too.
I love that, because I do think, but I really, what is so interesting is that, you know, it's very hard to come from a physical world where we're all so physical and we're really used to everything being physical. We've been trained to be physical, meta,
mm-hmm.
and all everything. So it almost feels like the right way to enter into freedom. And if spirit, if being in spirit and inspired was freedom, let's just say that's our goal, freedom to be exactly who we are,
mm-hmm.
we enter through the physical, because that's really what most of us understand.
That's a brilliant point. I love that. Yeah. I love that you said that. Right, so here's the deal. You know, people want to ascend. You hear a lot of talk about ascension. Okay.
Yes.
Newsflash, you ain't ascending anywhere. Unless you're in your body. Seriously.
No.
Your body's the vehicle.
Yes.
Your body is the vehicle. It's not about this.
No.
Oh, you know, come into your body, really ground yourself in your body. Notice it for the miracle that it is. It's amazing.
Yeah.
And then once you're in your body properly, you're fully plugged into all of the stuff that's available to you, then we're going to move. You know, then it's going to get really interesting.
Totally. It's like asking you to go out of your body when you never really learned to come into it in the first place.
Exactly. So, yeah.
I love that.
Yeah,
and
so it becomes a spiritual bypass.
Yeah.
So, the body's not an accident. The body is our soul. The body is the physical representation of the soul. So this is taking a spiritual turn. I don't know, we have these conversations.
Yeah, but it's so true. I mean, ultimately, what are we doing? We're not just coming down to lie to breathe, right? We're coming down because we want to heal in some way.
Yeah.
But what do all of us have in common that we want to heal? Bypass all the kind of personality stuff, you know, this and that and this. Mm. We all have that stuff. So ignore all that for a moment, our ego personality. What do all humans have to heal? Mm-hmm. You know, aside from that, we all want to really come home.
Yes.
It's almost like we're spirits born into bodies that left the bodies before we understood what it meant to be in a body. And breathing brings us back.
It totally brings us back. I think, you know, we're born with it's like a longing for connection. It's a longing for deep, profound connection. And a lot of us we all have it. But a lot of us, I feel, are looking for it in the wrong places. So we're looking for it maybe in obscurity, maybe it's drugs that numb our senses. The intention is so good. The intention is to commune with the universe, to be at one with the universe. But it's not going to happen through oblivion. It's going to happen through awareness. So your awareness, guess what, folks? Your breath. Come to your breath.
Yes.
Become fully aware of who and what you are. Explore who and what you are. Bingo.
Come home,
it can take you anywhere you need to go. In terms of what we've all got in common, I believe it is that longing for source, it's longing for however you want to term it.
Longing to understand who and what we are.
Totally.
You said it, what is it? Longing to understand who we are, what we are, and why we're here. And
exactly.
What is our purpose? What are we here?
So for me, the breath is the vehicle
by
which we can do that. And of course, there are other vehicles.
Yeah.
I just find this one to be a particularly effective one. It's a very powerful one. I've tried everything that's out there, pretty much. This one rocked my world. It really did.
When you did it for the first time, you were blown away.
I just couldn't believe it because I considered myself somebody who was fairly awake. And I was quite, I'd done my stuff, I was working on stuff. And I'd had a pretty full-on Ashtanga and Iyengar practice for a good few years, And I love yoga, I still love yoga. But when I did it, I remember somebody giving me the gift of a session. I was like, breathing. Hello, I'm a yogi. You know, you've got to tell me about pranayama, baby.
And pranayama, baby.
And I did. Yeah. And I just couldn't believe it. I got this connection that took me, it's just totally profound. It's ineffable, really. But let's just say I had the strongest connection with source or spirit or God or whatever you want to call that, with myself, that I'd ever had.
Yeah.
And that really got my attention because it happened in 50 minutes. I thought, hold on a minute. I've done all this stuff for decades, and in 50 minutes, I'm experiencing this. Amazing, so it had me right there.
Yeah.
And then, of course, I booked 14 sessions on the trunk. And you spot an addictive
person.
So I booked 14 sessions on the trunk. I go to do those sessions, and it's Kleenex time. And I'm just, all my stuff is coming out, massively.
Wow.
And I was expecting these more spiritual experiences, and I was getting, snotty hankies and all sorts of stuff. But brilliant, because I was getting clearer.
Yeah.
And at the end of that period, I was just like, whoa, this is the next stage. This is where I'm going. I'm going to follow this. And I couldn't believe that nobody knew about it.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe it. This thing that was just the most powerful thing, nobody knew about it. Nobody had ever heard of it. I was searching all over the world, literally all over the world, 80 countries. Never come across it. So I thought, okay, I can do something about that.
Yes.
My previous job was PR. I used to do PR.
Yes.
In the aerospace industry. So I'm like, I can do that.
Yeah.
I can help raise the profile.
Yeah.
And that's what we've done. And that's why now, from the beginning,
yeah.
Where my litmus test is actually London taxi drivers, I have to tell you.
Mm.
I checked in with London taxi drivers at the beginning, and I used to say what I did, and they go, great scam, you get people to pay you for breathing, fantastic. And now they go, oh yeah, my breath. yeah, or my wife, she has panic attacks, it's related to breath, isn't it? It's like, it's coming in, babes, it's really coming in. Right into mainstream,
right, that's mainstream. Where we want
it. Not wacky,
yeah,
out there, you yeah know, where it came from in the 60s with, you know, beautiful holotropic and rebirth.
Yes.
But it had a bit of a wacky image.
Yeah.
I'm gonna just bring it right into the middle. It's breath, folks. There's nothing wacky about it.
Yes.
It's oxygen and energy, and you need it because it's your life force.
You know, yeah, there's something I've always found very interesting is that we almost give away our autonomy. And I think in healing ourselves, you know, from when we're very young, we get, you know, we're not well, and then our parents take us to a doctor. And then if we get this in our head, we need to go to somebody else to tell us how to heal ourselves. But the truth is that there's no greater person to heal you than you. No one can feel you like you can. But it's just that it's all being lost. We have forgotten how to feel and listen to ourselves. And I think that breath and really working with breath is just, it brings us back to the sensitivity that we all have,
yeah,
to listen, to feel, and to heal. And if you look at cancer now, they're healing cancer with oxygen. Now, that often makes me think, okay, there are many diseases on this planet that are born and flourish in oxygen-starved environments. So that means we're not breathing. We're not breathing like we should be breathing because there's enough oxygen for us to be oxygenating our physical body.
That's a great point. And you're right, the hyperbaric oxygen chambers and stuff, they're having massive success with that. I mean,
yes,
really amazing. And if you want to create cancerous cells from healthy tissue in the lab, what do you do?
Cut off oxygen.
There you go. So, you know, 1958, I think it was, Otto Warburg.
Amazing, Nobel Prize winner.
Yeah. Cancer cells cannot proliferate in fully oxygenated.
But that was in 1950, so why is it taking so long? So I mean, we're really slow on the uptake, aren't we?
Well, you made a couple of points there. The
yeah
other one was brilliant, in my opinion, is, you know, self-empowerment. You know, breath, self-empowerment. We are empowering ourselves as we breathe, bringing in more life force. So it's about becoming your own sovereign, really.
Yes.
It's about your own sovereignty, and it's about really becoming your own healer. We are all our own saviors.
Yeah.
You know, nobody's going to do it for you. Your path is your path, and as you rightly said, you're the best person because you're actually living it, you're feeling it. So I love that about it.
Yeah.
It's truly self-empowering. We're not just going
yes
through the motions. My job when I'm with somebody is to get them flying solo ASAP.
Yes.
The people that were in the workshop today have now got the tools to be able to go
that's
away and initiate the self-practice, which is really where the action is.
Yes. Also, it's I love what you say. It's like we have the greatest healing tool right under our noses. Isn't that like the nature of human beings? Everything is right here, and we try to complicate it all. But you know, nature is exquisite, and it's given us everything we need. But we have to actually step up and say, okay, I really trust this human body. It was made by nature, and it would have given me the tools to heal me. So start with the mind, understand that it gave us the nose so that we could breathe ourselves into wellness. It gave us our body so that we could actually move the energy with all our acupressure. You know, when you were doing the acupressure, that was really interesting because it's a passion of mine. I absolutely love Chinese medicine. I've just finished an acupressure mastery course. So it's really a passion, and I love the idea that as we were breathing, facilitators were walking around to move energy on pressure points. And, you know, especially up here by the collarbones, it's really a profound area down, you know. And so it, you know, there's a lot of energy moving. And there was something else, you know, with yoga, with the breath, with moving, because I'm obviously a yogi,
yeah,
this
yeah
is my passion, but moving the energy in the body. You know, you only have to see a body of still water in nature, and that water doesn't move, it rots, and eventually it becomes bilharzia, and it's now stagnant, sick water. But the stream that flows is still fresh, it's happy, it goes. We are 70% water. What happens to us if we don't move our energy?
Yeah.
If that breath is not moving?
And that's exactly the point of the acupressure.
Yeah.
You know, we get stuck in places. So our job today,
yeah,
amazing facilitators that are working with me,
yes,
it's very simply, look at your body, look at your breath, look at where it's going, great,
yeah,
look at where it's not going, let's just put a little bit of pressure on it to encourage it to come in, which it does. And you saw with the demonstration, the guy, it was a belly breather actually, which is 20% of the population.
Yes.
And we demonstrated that it was possible to move his breath right up into his upper chest just by positioning and by a little bit of acupressure. So, you know, we can all open up. And guess what? You know, when you open up your breath, you're opening up to life. It's totally, there's a total parallel. You look at somebody breathe, you can completely see how they're doing life. Mm-hmm. You can see their behavioral patterns showing up in the breath, you know, if you've been trained to do that. It's amazing that breath is a reflection of our life. So for me, I just feel like the more I open up my breath, the more I open up to what's available for me. Mm-hmm. When I control, the control mechanism, which of course we've all got, you know, controlling is kind of a contraction for me.
Yeah.
It feels like a contraction, it feels like a making smaller than we really are. So when we control, which of course we love to do, it's a bit like saying to the universe, no, don't come in, we don't want anything, just leave it. And what happens is, as you breathe more, let go of the reins, and you can go like, actually, this feels pretty good, you know?
Yeah.
And more, oh, this feels great. Oh, now I'm really, yeah, okay then.
Right? Yeah.
And you're just saying, yes, please, bingo, you know, breathing in. So it's about opening up to what's around us, because there's so much around us that we just don't get a look in on, because we're so bothered about, you know, this fear-based control.
Totally. Yeah. I there's a lot of psychology in breathing, you know, a lot, that if you think that prana, or as you said, chi, or whatever you want to call it, life force, that moves through our bodies and fills our lungs, is the only reason why we're all alive, why we're walking around and doing the things we're doing. The moment you stop that, and I know this is logical, but to put it into the logical steps, the moment you stop breathing, you stop living. You will take your first breath as you come into life and your last breath as you go out of life, and the moment that breath stops, it's finished. But we, as humans, stop breathing. You see people on the phone and they're not breathing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And there's no breath coming in, the stress, the breath stops. And it's almost on an unconscious level, a fear of life. You're actually blocking breath, you're blocking life.
True.
So it feels like there's a really big synergy. If you're smoking, there's another layer to that. Because not only are you blocking life, but you're actually, in a way, unconscious to yourself, are self-harming.
Yeah, totally. Completely. Having said that, I have to say, smokers have incredible inhales. Think about it. They do. They just have these great inhales. And I see these smokers, I work with them, it's like, wow, that's amazing. Now, if we can just get rid of the cigarette, you're going to be really
good. Yeah, exactly.
So it's true. They do. You know, there is a sense to that. So smoking is suicide. I mean,
it is.
You know, it's suicidal. I used to smoke 40 a day.
Yeah.
Totally oblivious to what it really meant. And, you know, just completely.
Did you just click one day what it was?
I did. I started to do yoga, and yoga really changed things for me. Yeah. Yoga really, I always say, saved me a little bit. Mm. I saved myself, but yoga was an amazing tool.
Mm.
And I just came into my body, because I used to live here, totally. I would never go down into the body. And then I came into my lungs, and I was like, holy shit, what am I doing? And I could feel, with every cigarette, I could feel what was happening. And I was like, whoa, this is history. I'm not doing this anymore. Before, it was an intellectual concept. I knew it was bad for me, but I had no physical or emotional reality of that. And when I came in, it was like, oh, I feel it now. Now I'm stopping, and it was done.
Yeah,
was
you really done. Connected to
it.
Oh,
it's amazing, amazing.
Yeah, I could tell you a story about me in an ashram. I mean, this is like 12 years ago, and me smuggling cigarettes and stuff into an ashram, because I was still of that, like, it's fine, until I had the very same experience.
Yeah.
Something about your connection to this life changes, and this sensitivity, you suddenly feel your body in a different way.
Totally.
It's magic.
Well, it was what we were doing today. The big thing in the workshop today was grounding.
Yeah.
People were really coming into their bodies in a new way.
Yeah.
And that's just, it changes everything. Totally changes everything. It's such a profound thing to do.
It was really, really profound, and I think it's something that I'm definitely going to carry on doing. Yay! So What do you think? I mean, is there any similarity between rebirthing, holotropics, and transformational breath?
So, I think of rebirthing and holotropic as the sort of grandparents of that. And they both, you know, they were initiated with great intention, and I really respect both Leonard Orr and also Stanislav Grof in the leadership. However, I find them a bit unwieldy, and I find them a little bit dogmatic in terms of rebirthing. You're supposed to do 10 sessions with a female facilitator, 10 sessions with a male facilitator, just to clear your birth experience. How do you know that? I don't know how it's possible to know that, so unless somebody's got a direct line to the big guy. It seems quite dogmatic to me, and really, I think that the reason I chose transformational breath rather than the other two things, it was self-empowerment. It encourages you to not be with a facilitator. You learn how to do it, and then you start your solo practice. And you might come back and work with me once in a while, or you might come to the retreat, or you might go deep and do some big stuff.
Yeah.
But actually, it's about self-empowerment. It's not about dependence on somebody else. With holotropic, it was a product of Esalen and West Coast thing. It's just very, you know, we draw afterwards and there's drumming and there's dancing. It's great fun.
It is.
But what I liked about transformational breath, it's neat, it's succinct, it's portable. You don't need any paraphernalia. You were given it this afternoon. Yeah. It's yours. Job done. Yeah. So that's what I love about the simplicity. And also, I really like the quality control, to be honest. The training is extremely, extremely of a high standard. And my teacher, Judy Kravitz, the lady who developed this, does not pull any punches. She is like the Jimi Hendrix of breath work, and she just takes it to a whole different level.
She's a beautiful lady.
She's amazing, absolutely amazing. So so what I liked about it was the quality control, that she really cared about the fact that we were going to be with people and they were going to be in very vulnerable states. Mm. She wants you absolutely on the ball.
Yeah.
And it's pretty full-on training, but it's great, and I love that about it. I love the fact she cares so much, and I love the fact that everybody who's trained certified in this, you can really know that they've done a great job, they've got a lot of experience
behind it.
So it's not in any way kind of hippy-trippy, which is kind of the image that the older breathworks had sometimes. Right. And I have immense respect for both modalities, but I think that what we've done now is we've got a contemporary form that's easily transmittable.
You know, I think something that we're all moving towards is freedom.
Yeah.
And I think that freedom is a very big deal. You know, if you are empowering, if you are saying to somebody, come into my sector and do it my way and pass it my way, it feels like a religion again, to be honest. But I think we are really, all of us, are moving towards freedom. And I mean, the same as me, when I teach yoga, I'm like, I don't want to be teaching you forever. You need to learn how to do this, and your self-practice will be your salvation. That's going to be your journey home. And I think ultimately that's what you really want to do. You know, there's so many people in the world to get to. You don't want to, you know, you need to get around. You need to learn that quick.
Somebody said that to me. Exactly. From a business point of view, it's not very good, is it? If you're encouraging people to you know, go off and do their own thing, I'm like, have you seen the people out there? Do you know how many people breathe on planet Earth? So that has never really been a problem for me. I'm quite happy, and I love it actually. There's nothing nicer than when you see somebody who really does, they just pick up the ball and they run with it. And I'm like, you know, I'm communicating with them or something.
Yeah.
And you hear what's happening with them. It's just, it's fantastic. That's off the scale in terms of job satisfaction.
That's amazing.
But yeah, it's a big planet, and there's a lot of people who need to learn to breathe, so
that's
the deal. And that's really, you know, more than transformational breath.
Yeah.
My thing really is, I'd like to raise awareness on breath generally, so that it might be somebody reading a newspaper article, and they might say, oh, you know, maybe I should go to yoga class, or go to the gym down the road, or they might even just start breathing in their abdomen if they Google it, you know, oh, don't know, breathing is good for you. So it's not necessarily, you've got to come and do it my way, it's just like, folks, there's a really, really useful tool. It's sitting right beneath your noses. Plug into it, because it can rock your world, and it can seriously change, create change, permanent change, really profound, positive change, mass alliteration. And you know, it's just a no-brainer. You don't need any equipment. You just need you and a place to breathe. Fantastic. So that's my goal, really, is to get the whole planet breathing better.
Learn to breathe for a bit of ease. If you want to get hold of Alan, and this is something that does interest you, Alan is backwards and forwards in London doing workshops, and he also lives sadly, on Lanzarote.
It's tough.
It must be
hard. Somebody's got to do it. Lanzarote
is where he does a lot of workshops and retreats.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if you can drag yourself out there.
It's tough. You know, house overlooks ocean,
sunshine,
volcanoes, you've got 365 days of sun a year. It's hard.
Oh, really good food is just so tough.
It's great. We have, you know, the retreat was there purely because when I found it, I said to you, I couldn't believe nobody knew about it.
Yeah.
So I knew I could help with that. And then I thought, what would happen if you put people in an environment where they're supported? And all the things they normally have to do have already been done for them.
Yes.
They can just really relax and they can really look after themselves and go inside and go deep. So that's what we did, and that's what Breathing Space Retreats is about. It's on Lanzarote. If you haven't been, amazing island, amazing. Literally earth, air, fire, water. We've got volcanoes, 350 volcanoes. A lot of interesting energy, but it's a very balanced place elementally.
Yes.
So when people come in, they come in all sorts of states, often very stressed. Within a day, they're down.
Amazing.
So that's where you come if you want to do quantum change.
Yes.
And Aries, we're not known for our patience. I like stuff to happen quickly. I like to get results quickly. I like to see people transforming quickly. And that's what the retreats are about. So 3 to 7 days, people come for 5 or 6.
Yeah.
You're going to have to come over at some point, don't you?
Oh, the pain! I'm going to have to go to Lanzarote and
this is your job. This
and
is what you
eat
do
good
for
food. And oh, I'm going to have sun. That's going to be awful.
I've got the most amazing bodywork. Some bodywork with breath. Bingo.
You know what? The pain. I'm already thinking. But I'm going to do it for you.
Hey. Oh, I see a halo. There's a halo period.
Exactly. Amazing. Thank you so much for this amazing day and for sharing all of this. It really is just the future, really. A lot of people out there and here that need to breathe.
Absolutely. Yeah. I think so. And for me, it's really, I'm interested in psychotherapy and anything really that creates change. For me, it's a body-led psychotherapy.
Yeah.
And it's really the future of psychotherapy. There's a place for talking.
Yeah.
But actually, let's use the body's wisdom. Let's allow the body to lead us and show us what it can do.
Really?
Yeah. So that's really where it's at. That's where we're heading.
That is totally where it's at, and I'm loving it. It's a new, very safe, perfectly great way of just healing, and through a way of altered consciousness. You're altering your states of consciousness.
Yeah.
So I know we've journeyed the ayahuasca route. Okay, I'm now journeying the breath route.
Yeah.
And this is available for everybody, and that's what's so great. And you know, there are many different ways to get here, but this, if somebody is, it doesn't matter whether you're flexible or not flexible, whether you're, you know, skinny or fat or whatever, this is your way to rebalance, just to come home and to really ground down into your body and to experience life the way we're all meant to, authentically, you know, and I'm really just so grateful for this work. Thank you so much.
Me too.
Thank you. So all of you, if you want to get hold of Alan again, it is thebreathguru.com. And I'm going to let Alan tell you what he told us in our class today, what that is all about. The Breath Guru's strapline is...
Yeah, so Breath Guru. So it's not about being, I'm a guru. I am a teacher. That is what I do, definitely. But it's more about you are the guru, your breath is the key. And that's really what I've noticed over the years is that the breath can really do anything. As far as I'm aware right now, it's limitless. I've seen it do incredible healing on the physical, the mental, emotional. It can take you into some amazing spiritual states. You can go up into samadhi, into God realization states. I've yet to find any boundaries. I don't think there are any, but I'll tell you if I find any. So the breath guru thing is just, you are the guru. It's exactly what you've been saying. We're all our own healers. We're all our own saviors. We are all our own gurus. The time for that whole 30 years in a cave, it's over. You know, we don't have time for that. We need to get moving, people. So the breath will take you anywhere you need to go. It can create healing on every level of your being, seen and unseen. It's definitely, definitely worth checking out.
Namaste.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Thank you, everybody. Amazing.
Good. Thank you, sweetheart.
Thank you.
Right, I love your questions.
Oh.
I love that you're really